goal meet. So that's why we are trying to shift to. Okay, so let us quickly go back to what we have already discussed. So we have talked about Malad. You all can see my screen, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine.
Yes,
So
sir.
last class we were discussing about Malad and Lee Chatelier's theory. We talked about what are the two zones that we define, heat generation and heat conduction. Okay, and how to balance or talk about the balance of heat or conservation of heat. And based on that, we assume that heat is propagating back through layers of gas. Okay, and with that assumption, we derived a relation for flame speed and flame thickness. Okay, so this is what we did in the last class. It was a long derivation, but I hope you understand. Otherwise, you can just I have uploaded these slides. Okay, so you can revisit them once, and if anyone is have any doubt or questions, we can discuss separately. You can ask in class, or later we can again discuss it further. Okay, so this I think is clear. Now then, we talked about Zeldovich, Frank Kamenetsky, and Semenov theory. So this is a more advanced theory than what we discussed, as it also takes into account diffusion of species. Okay, basically energy transported by diffusion of species, and these are the final results. Okay, we have not gone into the derivation, but the final results, basically it gets the flame speed, which is also quite close to what we got through Malad and Chatelier's theory. Okay, so it is not very different from that, and but it gives much more in much more variables are involved, and the theory is little bit more complex than Malad and Lee Chatelier. So Lee Chatelier is the simplest theory that you will come across in commercial for a premixed flame. Okay, then we talked about comprehensive theory. So how do we define governing equations and computational boundary conditions? And then we looked at some structure of methane air and hydrogen air flames. So this is what we discussed last day, how your species mole fraction changes when you move across a flame. Okay, so I think you people are clear. We talked about how reactants decrease, product increase, and heat release. So these things we have discussed in the last class. Okay, now let us move ahead. So this all we discussed: temperature, CO2. Let me, okay, I was opening one case. Let me open that case for you. So this is the case I showed you result. This is the case from where I'm showing you results. Okay, so if you want to see some contours, let us say temperature. So you all can see this.
Yes, sir.
So this is how a flame looks like. So this is basically a Bunsen burner flame, which is hitting a wall. Okay, one wall is here. So let us ignore the wall. Our interest is this region. Okay, so this is how temperature varies. You can actually zoom in and see. So this is the cold region. You can see the temperature here if I right click. So it is 300 degrees Celsius. Initial temperature is 300. So this is the methane jet that is coming. Okay, this all blue region is methane jet, unburnt cold methane. So once it comes to this region, green region, it starts getting heated up. This is the preheat zone. Okay, what we have talked about here, let us go back to, yeah. So this green color you see, region of conduction, this is that, this green color. So this is very small and very thin region. In PPT, I have shown it is a bit exaggerated, but in actual flames, it is like a few millimeters or less than a millimeter thick. So here the flame starts getting heated up, and then we see the final temperature. So it will reach around 2000 to 2200 Kelvin. Okay, so this is how temperature plots look like. And again, this, if you look at You look at a flame or candle, what you will see is, you will see something bright. Okay, it does not look dark here. Can anyone tell me what is the reason? So here you see that it is completely bright, but in this CFD you see that this is dark. Why don't I see that bright region?
And yes, you mean inside the, I mean where we should have cold fuel?
Yes. So here
that is because of light getting through there, something you were talking about that in the first
few
lectures.
See, this is a cone, so it surrounds the unburned fuel. Okay, so we are seeing a 3D picture. So because this conical shape surrounds that, so inside dark region we are not able to see. But if you do some laser visualization, so for example, this has put some laser, some advanced diagnostics. So let us say that he has cut the flame into half. So we can see inside that it is dark. Similarly, what we are seeing here that inside is very dark. Now let us look at some species. So let us say I want to see mass fraction of mole fraction. You can see both of them. So let us say O2. O2 will also be similar. So here O2 is maximum. Inside O2 is almost zero. Okay. Why? Because O2 is consumed. This is a stoichiometric ratio, stoichiometric mixture. So we have O2 coming in the fuel, but it is finished in this blue region. But if you look at the sides, so sides we have O2 because this is open to atmosphere. So O2 is also coming from sides, but inside the flame, O2 is all burnt up. Okay, let us have a look at methane. Again, methane will be similarly. Here inside the cone, we have methane. Outside it is finished, consumed. Let us have a look at other species. Let us say at CO. So it forms at, so this bright region, what you see, this is the main reaction zone. Okay, so all the species like OH is specially considered as a main marker of flame. Let us have a look at OH. So OH looks like this. So where you see very strong concentration of OH, that is where mostly we see that flame is situated. And again, you see OH is decreasing like this. What we discussed last class, OH is going down smoothly. Yes. So this is what we discussed, right? OH is coming down smoothly. We see a peak here and then it comes down. So this is what you can see more clearly here, right? Any other species? Okay, CO we should talk about. CO. Okay, so CO is mainly formed here and then it is reducing. What we have seen here. Okay, so this is a different scale. We can change the scale, we'll get the same plot. And once the CO is finished, it is basically getting burnt and CO2 is getting formed. So if you look at CO2, after CO, CO2 is formed. And then this is full of CO2. And let us see where, you get picture. So this is also the plot for temperature. Inside is dark, cold, then you get very high temperature outside. I wanted to show you heat release. Let me see where it is. Something reactions. Yeah, heat of reaction. Oh, what is this? And some problem is there. Anyway, let us have a look at kinematic rates. So you have different reaction, okay? So we have a mechanism. Remember what we discussed in kinetics class, that we have different elementary reactions. So this is the list of that reaction. Reaction 1, reaction 2, how and where they are taking place. Okay, so I also don't remember what reaction is what, but what I'm trying to show you is that if you look at this V region, most of the reactions are taking place there. Okay, so let us go back to our slide. So we have seen, anyone want to see any other species or something you want to see? We can look at it now. Density, okay, yeah, this is an important parameter. So see, look at this density. This is the unburned gas density is almost equal to air density, atmospheric density. Once it crosses the flame front, then the density is significantly lower and velocity will also increase. We look at the velocity. Yes, there's some problem, I think. Anyway, so let us look at steam. That case is not getting it properly, but you see that velocity is getting much higher here as compared to this. I think it has not opened properly, otherwise you'll see a very different velocity. No, velocity is not showing properly. Let us forget about velocity. Let us stick to density. Yeah, density is showing correctly. Okay. Anyway, so just I wanted to give you a flavor of how a case looks like. Let us go back to our slides. Okay, so let me ask a question here. So what we have discussed is for, let us say a line across this. Okay, so this is the line I'm talking about. As you move across the flame, as you go from cold region to hot region, this is how variables change. Okay, now let us say that I want to move from here to here. How will the plot look like? If I want to plot CO in this or this region, how it will look? Similar to this or different from this?
Similar, sir.
Yes. So here we say that this is X, but X could be in any direction. Generally, we talk about the center line, but anywhere along the flame surface, you take an arrow. Whatever, if you take this line perpendicular to flame front, then you will get a plot like this. So that is applicable for entire flame front, not only the central axis. Okay. So that was about hydrogen also. We have almost discussed yesterday. Now let us talk about the measurement. So we have looked into theoretical development. How do we talk about flame speed? We have looked into CFD or how flame structure looks like. Now let us see how do we measure flame speed experimentally. Okay. So for flame speed measurement, we have two types of methods. One will be propagation method, where the flame is propagating or moving. We'll see in a minute what it means. And another method is stationary, where the flame is not moving at all. So remember, for example, we discussed about the tube, there the flame is not moving. So similarly, we have different apparatus and different techniques where we measure the speed of the flame. And why this is important? Because in premixed flame, the most important parameter in a premixed flame is flame speed. Flame speed, flame thickness, flame temperature, all this is important, but flame speed is one of the characteristics and most important parameter for a premixed flame. Based on this, you design your device. So for example, I want to design a Bunsen tube, a Bunsen burner. I must know what is the flame speed of the fuel that I'm using. Based on that, I can determine what is my flow rate so that the flame is stationary. It does not comes back or does not blows out, right? So that is why flame speed is very important. So to determining flame speed, most of the methods that we'll talk about are based on flame imaging. Okay, we take a photo of flame and we see how it moves or where it stands. So when you image, you can use luminous photography. That is basically just take a photo. Okay, normal photo, you see where the flame is very bright, there you define flame front. So for example, if we go back, So for example, what we have seen initially, this can be defined as luminous photography, or one more image we had, this one. So this can be classified as luminous photography. So this is just a simple picture, right? And this is a laser diagnostic. So we are like looking at the mid section of a frame. Okay. So we'll not go into what exactly is, but let us define what are the various ways in which we can measure frame loss. Okay. So we'll talk about luminous. Then there are two methods, shadowgraph and Schlieren. So you guys have heard about this, shadowgraphy or Schlieren photography?
No, sir.
You have studied gas dynamics or compressible fluid mechanics? You have that course or no, not?
No, sir.
Okay. So basically these two techniques, they are based on gradient, okay, density gradient. So, okay, I've not made slides, so explain this, but okay, we can do it later. For now, you can just understand that these are these two techniques, Schlieren and shadowgraph, they are based on density gradient. Okay, so in a flame, your density changes, right? Your unburned fuel is much more dense than burned fuel, burned products. So there's a stark step change in density. So shadowgraphy and Schlieren can capture that. They will show you the flame front. Okay.
छुट्टी हो गई क्या? हाँ
हाँ तू तो जा घर पे, देर तो हो गई।
अबे बहुत मारूंगा। अरे
मारेगा तो जा।
चलो, कहा था कि ये टाइम मत रखना, कहा
क्या
था ये टाइम मत रखना, नींद आता है।
ये मिश्रा बोल।
अरे मिश्रा जी कहाँ है?
अरे मिश्रा मैसेज कर रहा है, मिश्रा बात करना। आप क्या मैसेज कर रहे हैं?
क्या हुआ गणपत भाई, क्या हाल है?
बस बढ़िया मिश्रा, तू सुना।
बस अब क्या बोले भाई। अरे
सही है, रिकॉर्डिंग हो रही है इसमें।
लीव किया जाए क्या भाई?
चलने दे अपने, क्या कर रहे हैं?
नेट जा रहा है,
हाँ
नेट जा रहा, नेट।
नेट सर का चला गया।
अरे नहीं मतलब अपना डाटा जा रहा है।
हाँ अब सब लेफ्ट हो रहे हैं अपन दो है।
अबे गजराज
बालाजी
भी है
हेलो।
क्या? हेलो
अबे
बालाजी
गजराज जी क्या? हाँ
भाई, तू सर को कॉल करना।
अरे यार मेरे पास उनका नंबर नहीं
नंबर नहीं है?
है।
अब तो एक ही रास्ता है यार, लीव करना।
छुट्टी हो गई आज की।
ओ भाई आ गए सर।
या आई लॉस्ट कनेक्शन। हाउ लॉन्ग वर यू वर वेटिंग फॉर, व्हाट वाज द लास्ट स्लाइड यू सॉ? हेलो यू पीपल कैन हियर मी? सो
यस सर,
यस सर।
आई डोंट नो वेयर इट स्टॉप, आई वाज कंटिन्यूअसली स्पीकिंग, सो टेल मी वेयर
सर, यू आई थिंक यू आर गोइंग टू टेल अबाउट दोज अदर टू, लाइक यू आर सेइंग अबाउट कम आफ्टर द ल्यूमिनस फोटोग्राफी अदर टूल्स।
ओके सो लुमिनस श्लेरियन यू आर नॉट, वी हैव टॉक्ट अबाउट श्लेरियन।
I did not get that, sir. After luminous
Okay, let me
photography, when
repeat.
you said about like compressible fluid dynamics, after that I got cut off.
Okay, so everyone was cut off at that point. So we'll start there. So let me, you can see my screen.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so basically what happens is, so anyway in future also if I don't get connected, just stay there, I will connect back. If I'm not able to connect, I will at least mail you. Okay, so just wait for a 5 minutes or so, and I will be back hopefully. Okay, so we talked about luminous. So this is just basically you take a photo of the flame and you define that this is my flame, and based on that you measure the speed. Then I talked about the shadowography and Schlieren. Okay, so these are basically based on density gradient. So as we discussed that if you go past a flame, density changes drastically, right? We have let me show it again. So this is the density, right? You see, this is a stark change in density. So initially we have something close to atmospheric. After that, it becomes very small. Okay, so 5 to 6 times change in density is observed across the flame front. Okay, now here you see within a very narrow region. Okay, this is a flame front, which could be like less than a millimeter. And across this flame front, there is a very large change in density. Okay, so basically what happens is that, let us briefly talk about density method. So, let us say that we thought you people are aware, but let us say that we have one box, okay, where I filled air. Some anything is there. Now, if light comes, it will pass straight through it if the density is same as outside density, right? Is this okay to everyone?
Sir, here density means like I mean we'll talk about that optical density, right, sir? Not the
density of the medium. Air density.
Just normal density.
Normal density.
Yes, sir.
So forget about the glass. Okay, glass will also offer some distortion, but let us say forget about the glass. This, let us say some region in here. Okay, that could be combustion product or anything. So if the density is the same as the surrounding density, then the light will pass straight. But if this region has a different density, okay, so it will bend the light because of refractive index. So the refractive index is dependent on density, that you are aware of. So refractive index, we say this is proportional to or density. Okay, I don't remember the exact relation, but this is somehow proportional to density. So refractive index controls your angle of, so light comes, it gets, Snell's law, you have studied in class 12th?
Yes, sir.
So I don't want to go much detail into that because we need some theory also, but just for your understanding, let us assume that where is that? Okay, so this shadowgraphy and Schlieren, this both are based on density. That's all. Don't think too much. Maybe some other class will go into detail how this is done, but these are based on density gradient. That's all. That is the basic philosophy behind this. And then we have some laser based techniques. So there are the different zones of a flame. Okay, where these techniques are effective. Schlieren absorbs this zone. So basically, if you capture a photo using Schlieren, you are basically capturing this zone. Okay, if you capture a, take a photo using shadowgraph, you are capturing this zone in a flame. And luminous zone is the outside zone where we almost get the higher temperature. See, but anyway, the point is that this delta is like order of millimeter, 1 mm, 0.5 mm. So it doesn't matter much for most of your practical applications what technique you use. Okay, unless you are doing some research work for practical cases, it doesn't bother you that what technique you are using, but how accurate is that? That is the only concern. Okay. So just a brief background, don't worry too much about these techniques. Now let us look at some methods, propagation. So we have three types of, three methods we'll discuss: plane tube propagation, spherical bomb, and soft film. You people are here? I need to check whether I'm connected or not. Yes, okay, good.
Yes, sir.
So plane tube is basically a linear propagation technique. Okay, so we have a flame, and the so we have a tube where we fill the fuel, and flame is going straight in that tube. We have seen the video initial classes, right? Similarly, we have spherical and bomb and soap film method. So these are spherical, flame propagates spherically outside. You will see in next slides. I'll have some photos. So this is what we discussed. Okay, so flame tube, basically you have a tube, you fill it with air and fuel mixture, and you ignite. So the flame propagates like this. Now in our simplified analysis, what we have assumed is that the flame front is flat, right? We say that flame front is perfectly flat, but in actual experiment, there are a lot of factors involved, okay? So there will be convection, which will distort the flame front, and because of wall effects, the flame front will be somewhat parabolic. So for example, if you talk about a cold flow, normal flow in a wall, how does the velocity profile looks like? Parabolic, right? Laminar flow in a channel or a tube.
Yes, sir.
So we talk about flat, but flat is a very ideal case. That will not happen in practice. So there are a lot of factors like parabolic velocity profile, buoyancy, and natural convection. These all will distort the flame. Okay, so this is not a very accurate technique. You can get some approximate flame velocity, but there are a lot of errors involved in this technique. Okay, so these are the various issues for flame tube propagation. Moving on, so then we'll talk about spherical bomb. So what we do is basically we have a big we have a vessel like this, which is spherical in shape, and then we have some window so that we can take image like this, and there we fill air and fuel, we fill the premix mixture and we ignite. So this is how the one vessel will look like. So we have different probes and all, but in principle it is a spherical inside, and once you burn your flame, the flame grows on like this. Okay, you can see this?
Yes, sir.
So what we need to do is we'll say what is the rate at which it is expanding, dr by dt, and using that we can calculate what is the flame speed. Okay, so this again we have a little derivation. Let us skip that for now. There are some other things I wanted to finish today. Okay, so for this spherical flame, now there are some assumptions also. Okay, the assumption is that this is how you derive flame speed. So this will be the you measure the rate of change of radius, and then you also multiply it by density of burnt and unburnt gases. So this is called expansion ratio. So we'll talk again about it. Let us hold it for the next class. So but let us look at the assumption. So the one challenge with this is that we have to assume that the flame front thickness and curvature are small. So which is not true if the flame is very small or very large. Okay, so if the flame is very small, the curvature effect will be there, and if it is very large, there then some other instability comes in. So that then also the measurement is not accurate. So basically you have to take in the middle when it is a little big but not very big. Then we have a very big assumption. We say that the pressure at any instant is uniform and constant, and there is no heat loss. And lastly, this is a valid assumption that chemical equilibrium is achieved. So that is perfectly fine, but as you can see that it is a closed vessel. Okay, so when you start burning, definitely it is going to increase the pressure and temperature. So at the later stages where you have a large flame, this SL measurements become wrong. Okay, so there is a very small range, a small radius where you can take this measurement accurately. But this is also not a great, it is a good method, but not a great method. So let us look at some other method. So one more method where we can, so what was the major limitation here? That pressure and temperature are increasing with time. Okay, so let us say I want to keep my pressure constant, because pressure temperature both will affect the flame speed, as we'll see in later slides. So that is a problem here in this method. So what can we do? We can use a soap bubble. Okay, so let us say I create a bubble and somehow fill it with unburnt mixture. Okay, once you ignite, it will start burning. So for this is a similar type of setup, but this will keep on expanding, and the pressure is roughly, you can say, approximately constant. So that is one major advantage over the bomb method, that the pressure remains roughly constant, and because this flame is flexible, and the unburnt gases temperature also does not increase so much. Okay, so these are also, this is also again a little difficult method to do, because you have to make a soap bubble, you have to fill it with gas, and there are some limitations. So this is again, we have the same formula. This flame speed will depend on the rate of change of radius multiplied by the expansion ratio. Okay, this is 1 by expansion ratio. So let me write. So SL is r drf by dt into 1 by sigma. So sigma is rho u by rho b. That is sigma. Okay, we will derive it in the next class. Okay, so don't worry too much about it, but let us look at the limitations. So this method cannot be used for measuring a gas dry mixture. Okay, so again, it, because you have to inject it in a bubble, it become wet. Some moisture will be there in that mixture, and because it is a bubble, so it may distort in some direction. It may not be perfectly spherical. So then your measurement becomes wrong. Then if you have fast flames, the flame front will not be smooth, as you have seen in the first video. If you get wrinkles and other type of instabilities, then you're not measuring a laminar flame speed. Then again, your method is erratic, or lot errors are very large. And heat loss to electrode and ambient is also giving some error to this method. Fine. Now let us go to stationary method, which are much more easy to do and sometimes more accurate. So one simple method is flame tube. So what we have discussed previously. So again, it will not be a flat; it will be a little curved. But if you supply fuel mixture at a given speed such that the flame front remains stationary, that is what we say is the flame speed SL. Okay, so it will be a little distorted, but we can get an approximate value of flame speed using this method. Is it fine? This we have already discussed a lot of times, so I hope you people are there, or I am again disconnected.
Yes, sir.
Okay, yes, sir. So flame tube is a very simple and useful method, but again, the flame front will not be very flat, so it has some error. So other method, this we have already discussed. You have Bunsen burner, measure the cone angle. You know what is the U, because you know what is the average velocity you are supplying. So if you measure U, you take a picture like this and you measure theta. Then can you calculate SL using this relation?
Yes, sir.
Right. So it is much more simpler. You just have a Bunsen burner, measure the angle, and find out laminar flame speed. Now the limitations with this is that there are heat losses to the wall, okay, and there are some non-uniformity also. We'll skip that, but you should know that it is not a perfect flame front. Okay. Then again, there is a diffusion from atmospheric air, which also, it is not a big error, but it also affects flame velocity measurement to a certain extent. Then if you have a large port, okay, if you have a large port here, then there are issues with flame going out or coming in like that. So this is a good method, but it has some limitations. So what is a perfect method? So let us talk about flat flame burner. So what is this is that you have a burner like this, where you inject fuel air mixture from here. So there are some beads or pebbles which make this flow uniform. Okay, so the idea is that the velocity profile is not parabolic here. We get a very uniform velocity. Okay, so for that we use a sintered metal disc. Okay, let me draw it. So let us say if you have a tube, okay, what sort of velocity profile you have? We'll have a parabolic velocity profile, right?
Yes.
But because of this sintered tube, okay, this has like porous plug. What happens is that the velocity profile that we get, that is much more flatter. Okay, it will. This method is not very good to draw. So because of this tube, the velocity profile becomes very flat. It is not a parabolic profile, but it becomes very flat. Because of that, we get a flat flame here. Okay, so this is how it looks. Or let us, so this is one flame I got from my experiments. But if you look at very standard controlled experiments, this is what I got from literature. So you see, can you see this flame? Can you see this flame? So this is a very ideal case. Okay, so this is one of the most accurate methods to measure flame speed, flat flame burner. So there is a company, I think Makina burn is a company which makes this type of burners, and using this you can get a very good measurement of flame speed. Now what is the issue here? How do we do that? So basically, when we define flame speed, so what we do is we have some flow rate. You know what is the flow rate? So we define, we measure the flame area, okay, obtained by any method. And because shadow and stain give the same area, so that error is eliminated. So there's no error there. Now I get this flame area and I divide the rate of burning. Okay, burning velocity can be obtained by dividing the flame area with volumetric flow rate. Okay, so what I'm saying here is that I know what is my m dot. Okay, by doing some Schlegelian or any other thing, I know what is the area of this flame. Okay, so can I define SL? M dot is equal to rho SL, rho AV. Right. So using that,
yes, sir.
Using that, we'll find SL. So this is one of the most accurate methods to measure SL. Now, one issue with this method is that we have cooling coils. Okay. So if you cool this mixture, the flame speed also changes. And when I talk about SL, SL is basically defined for uncooled mixture. Okay, now if you have uncooled mixture, there are issues with flame stabilization. It could like burn the disc, or it will go up, something like that. So what do we do is, we have some measurement at different flowing cooling rates. Okay, so let us say this is the cooling rate. I have some high cooling rate, then I have some low cooling rate, then I have much lower cooling rate, and then I extrapolate this plot to come to zero cooling rate. So when it meets this line, it means that cooling rate is zero. So at this point, this is the SL. This is my flame velocity. Is this okay to you, or any confusion?
Yes, sir.
Everyone is okay. So I will repeat. So this is a simple method. We are just providing fuel mixture. I measured the rate of fuel coming. I measured the area. What is the area of this flame? And using that, I get my velocity. What is the velocity at which flame is getting burned? Now the challenge with this method is that here we have cooling coils. You see this, in this region we have cooling coils which cool the flame. Okay, it basically cools the gases that are coming. So because of that, SL is also changing. Okay, flame speed changes because of cooling. So strictly speaking, when you define standard flame speed, I assume that there is no cooling at all. But we have cooling here. So what we can do is, we can have different values of cooling, and we'll extrapolate this to say that if there is no cooling, what will the flame speed? That's all we're doing here. Taking different cooling rates and extrapolating that value, so that we get adiabatic conditions, and that is for how we define flame speed. Is this clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay, yes. Great. Let us move ahead now. Now let us. So this is all about measuring flame speed. Now let us look at the factors. What influence laminar flame speed? Okay, so as you can guess that temperature will anyway affect that we have discussed in the last slide. Now we will see. So Makina flat flame burner, we talked that temperature is affecting the flame speed. How temperature is affecting, we'll see. Now again, pressure will also affect flame speed. Equivalence ratio will affect flame speed, and if you add some inert gas, that will also affect. So let us see step by step how it affects. So flame speed can be expressed in this form. Okay, so there is a long derivation. I don't want to go into that, but I just want you to notice a few things. You can see the dependence on temperature. Okay, it depends on unborn temperature, born temperature. It depends on pressure. Okay, and because it depends on born temperature, it also depends on equivalence ratio. Okay, so we have talked about temperature, pressure, equivalence ratio, and inert gas will again affect your temperature. So these are the various factors. You don't have to remember this relation. Okay, don't get worried that you have to remember all this, but I have written this just to show that what are the factors that are contributing to SL. These are the factors that we can show theoretically that this is how SL is dependent on temperature, pressure, and equivalence ratio. So let us have a look. So we have some simple plots. We'll quickly go through them. So let us see effect of temperature. So this is for methane flame. So what you can see is that if you increase the unburned gas temperature, you can see this x-axis where my pointer is.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the x-axis shows the unburned gas temperature and y-axis shows the flame speed. So let us not worry about the unit. It is in centimeters per second. So, and these are the different values measured by different researchers. Okay, so this is all for methane, but because of different measurement techniques, people have got slightly different values. Okay, ideally it should be on one line only. So what the general trend, what we can see is that as you increase temperature, flame speed is also increasing, right? And this is obvious because you see the Arrhenius rate. Okay, so it is dependent on temperature. Initial unburned temperature is also responsible. So this will increase the flame speed. Now this is for methane. Let us look at hydrogen. Similarly for hydrogen, if you increase the unburned temperature, which is shown in x-axis, the flame speed will increase. Okay, so this topic, I'm just showing you charts. You just note down the trends. For temperature, flame speed increases. For pressure, it increases or decreases. That is what you should remember. So in this plot, like we have a lot of data has been combined. So these are different researchers who have measured experimentally. Again, I told that different measurement techniques have different errors. So we have some range of measurements, but the trend is same for all of them. All of them say that as you increase unborn temperature, flame speed is going to increase. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Fine. So let us talk about pressure now. So what you see here is, so again, there are different data from different researchers. This is the curve fit sort of. So for methane, as you increase the temperature, pressure, flame speed is decreasing. Okay, why is this happening? Because increase of pressure means you have increased the density. So we have more gas to burn. The mass of gas that is passing through the flame front increases. So let me just draw it here. So this is the most simple example we'll consider. So in a tube, what is this? See, this is the problem of not having a blackboard. Right? If I have blackboard, I can do it very easily. Okay, so this is the flame front. This is a tube. This is a flame front. So this is fuel coming in. Now, we have some velocity that is coming. and we have some density. Okay, if I increase the density by increasing the pressure, right, then what this plot says that your film speed is also decreasing. Right, everyone agrees to that?
Yes, sir.
So we can also say that the reaction rate itself decreases because, like, on the product side, we have more and more gaseous products than on the reactant side, because reactant side we have only CH4 and O2. Product side we have H2O, which is vapor, CH4, CO2s, and other gases. Right?
So what you are saying is you are applying the Lee Chatelier's principle. So that might,
yes, sir,
that might work when you have a constant volume combustion. Okay, in general we'll talk about constant pressure. Okay, sorry, this was the this let us say okay, let me go to the next plot, then your doubt might be more clear. So what we see here is that because of pressure, flame speed is decreasing, but the fact is that this is one more plot, but the fact is that if you look at flux, mass flux, okay, that is increasing with pressure. So let us, it is a little bit complicated. So equivalence ratio relation is also shown. So what happens is, for equivalence ratio, let us look at one plot, one of these lines. So for equivalence ratio, for a pressure of one atmospheric pressure, if you look at this curve, this is how it varies with equivalence ratio. It increases and then decreases. Okay, so let us not worry about that. Let us see the effect of pressure. So you see that pressure is 0.5 here, 1 here, 5, 10. So as you increase pressure, your flame speed is coming down, right? You agree to that? As you increase the pressure,
yes, sir,
flame speed is coming down. But if you look at burning flux, okay, if you increase pressure, the burning flux is increasing. You understand? Although your speed is decreasing, but your density has increased. Okay. This is rho into S, rho U into SU. This is the burning, how you define burning flux. So if you increase the pressure, more amount, more mass or more flux of unburned gas is getting burned. So you cannot say that the reaction rate has decreased. The reaction rate has actually increased. If you look at this.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
So.
Okay, this is a good point. So let us continue this in the next class. Let me see what, we have some more plots. You have any class after this, or we can extend for 5-10 minutes more?
You can extend, sir.
Okay, good. So we have,
yes,
a few slides only. I just wanted to finish this today. So we have talked about this, and effect of pressure. Okay, similarly, effect of pressure, we see that velocity is decreasing for different fuels. This was only for methane, right? Now the same effect we can see for different other fuels. That's all. No. ज्यादा दिमाग नहीं लगाना है. सेम इफेक्ट, सेम ट्रेंड इज फॉलोड बाय अदर फ्यूल्स आल्सो. दैट्स ऑल. सो दिस वी हैव डिस्कस्ड. दिस अगेन नेक्स्ट क्लास वील हैव सम डिटेल्ड डिस्कशन. टुडे आई जस्ट वांटेड टू कवर अप सम टॉपिक्स. सो लेट अस मूव ऑन फ्रॉम हियर. ओके, नाउ लेट अस टॉक अबाउट इक्विवेलेंस रेशियो. सो व्हाट हैपेंस इज, यू सी, फॉर डिफरेंट फ्यूल्स नियर इक्विवेलेंस रेशियो 1, okay, roughly about 1.1 or something, we get the highest flame speed. Okay, and for equivalence ratio, very good, this is lean and this is rich, right? You all agree to this? Rich and lean, do you remember or you forgot? What is this thing?
Yes, sir.
So what is rich and what is lean for me?
I greater than one.
Rich means 5 greater than 1.
Anyway, so what that is okay, that we can see from here 5 is greater than 1, but physically what it means, what is more, what is...
There is more fuel than oxygen.
Okay, strike so this... Yes, please continue. Tell me.
Sir, according to stoichiometry, sir, fuel is more as compared to the reactant.
So, fuel is more if they are rich or lean side?
Okay, sir.
Rich. So, for rich mixture, fuel is more. For lean mixture, oxygen is more. Right? Everyone is okay with that? So, what will happen?
Yes, sir.
I burn a rich mixture, okay, my final product will have some reactant that is left. Okay, let us say I can, for a stoichiometric ratio, I can burn, let us say 1 kilogram of methane. Okay, so if I have a lean mixture, okay, the methane will be less, let us say 0.5 kilo methane is there. So the heat produced will be more for what? Rich or lean? Rich or lean or stoichiometry?
Stoichiometry, sir, because if, I mean, we are talking about like a given quantity, right? So like a volume or
yes.
something.
Yes.
So then stoichiometric would be more.
Yes. So stoichiometric ratio, I have the complete combustion. Okay, so whatever reactant we have, everything is burned. So that produces maximum energy, maximum temperature, and maximum flame speed. Now, if I go to the other, either side, either I go here, this side or that side, what is happening is something is in excess, either fuel is in excess or oxygen is more. So what is more is being left. Okay, so that is decreasing my total heat. That is decreasing my efficiency. We have some burned, unburned reactants that also has to be heated. So that changes your temperature and that changes your velocity, flame speed. Okay, so for any fuel in general, the flame speed will be maximum for, let us look at another part. Okay, so this is more clear. So flame speed should be maximum for near stoichiometric. It will be slightly rich, 1.1. So there you will get maximum temperature and maximum flame speed. And if you go to either side of this, either you go lean or rich, your flame speed will start to decrease. That is how equivalence ratio affects your laminar flame speed. Is this okay?
Sir, as we've seen in some previous lecture,
yes,
the flame speed will not be the correct representation of the heat given out, right, sir? So, richer would produce more energy, and then because of diffusion or something, or will
no
this?
But in general, for a standard case, rich flame will not completely burn. Okay, stoichiometric will completely burn. So
yes,
the flame speed, temperature, energy produced by a rich also will be less than laminar proportionately. Less than stoichiometric proportionately. Okay, so if you have 1 kilogram of methane, you burn it rich, you will get some energy. Now, if the same 1 kg of methane you burn stoichiometric, you will produce more energy. That is what I'm saying. Right?
Yes, sir.
Fine. So, so in this plot, what I wanted to show you is that, let me remove everything. So what we see here is that for different fuels, how your flame speed varies. Okay. So for propane, ethane, methane, they all follow the same trend, but there is some different in velocities. Okay, they are giving a narrow band. But if you look at higher hydrocarbons, they are matching very closely. You see, they're like following the same curve. So this is just an observation. You don't need to go much deeper because we need to look into reaction kinetics and we have to do detailed derivation to say why this happens. But we'll not go into that. But just for information, you should know that higher hydrocarbons have very close flame velocities, while lower hydrocarbons have some differences. Okay, that is what being shown in these plots. Now let us talk about okay, these are some other fuels. So for example, hydrogen is having the highest flame speed among the general fuels that we'll talk about. Hydrogen is very fast. Then we see other fuels that we have already discussed. So mainly in general, fuels will peak at 1 or 1.1, but for very diffusing species like hydrogen or CO, they also peak at very rich cases. So that is a special case. Let us not go into much detail, but there are exceptions for this species, as you can see in this plot, right? Okay, now let us talk about inert gas addition. So what will happen with inert gas?
It will increase the pressure, right, sir? Just increase
the
pressure.
No, I will maintain the pressure constant. Let us say this is atmospheric flame and I am having a fuel air mixture and I add inert gas. So it will dilute the fuel. It will add extra component which has to be heated. Okay. Now the specific heat of that gas will determine the maximum temperature. So helium has the lowest specific heat, it will give the highest temperature. Nitrogen has the highest specific heat. Okay, so what is happening basically is that these gases are not reacting. So we are just heating that gas. If you increase the proportion of that gas, then it like takes out heat. That's all is happening. Okay. So is it clear or you people are confused?
Why would the speed depend on that, sir? Because it's taking heat and that affects the velocity or?
Yes, velocity is dependent on temperature, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let us talk about this nitrogen. So this is what we discussed. Okay, so if we have nitrogen, which means that we have air, oxygen plus nitrogen. So this is what it looks for, equivalence ratio. This plot is there. This is for nitrogen. Nitrogen means nitrogen plus air. Now, if instead of nitrogen, I have fuel, methane plus oxygen plus argon, or let us say helium. So I replace, let us say in the atmosphere, I replace nitrogen by helium, so I get this curve. That is what I'm saying. Now, why is this? Is because this has a lower specific heat. So it requires less heat to get heated up.
Okay. So, in an ideal case, if we just have methane and oxygen, that would have even much higher peak, right?
Yes. So that will be very high. So in general, we burn in atmospheric air that has nitrogen. So it is a dilutant. It is an inert gas which takes heat. Okay, what you are saying is you take oxygen plus methane, burn it in a closed chamber, that will generate large amount of heat. But in general, we are dealing with atmospheric conditions where we have nitrogen in large quantities, right? So this nitrogen is basically taking away your heat, that is cooling your flame. Okay, so if, okay, that is a good point. I will add one more plot. I will show you how oxygen, if you have pure oxygen instead of air. So this is what, this is air. Oxygen plus nitrogen. Okay, so if you have pure oxygen, this will be very high. Let me add that plot in the next class. We'll talk about it. Fine. Let me just finish it. I may have one or two more slides. Okay, that is all. Fine. We'll talk about frame thickness in the next class. So I hope you people are clear with what we talked today.
Sir, I have one question, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, when we accelerate the vehicle, sir, actually we are increasing the fuel supply.
Why you are talking about the vehicle? I'm just talking about normal flame. take, let us say, Bunsen burner flame?
No, sir. Sir, I am just trying to analogize that thing, sir.
Okay, tell me what you want to do. Sir,
when we accelerate the vehicle, sir, actually we are supplying more fuel, means we are giving more rich mixer. And sir, but the speed of the vehicle increases and the power increases. But whatever you said, sir, that is contradicting.
Okay, so when you burn fuel in an engine, it is mostly it has much excess of air.
Okay, yes, sir. So
when you increase fuel, it never goes to rich mixture. It is always less than stoichiometry.
Always less.
In general, I'll do one thing. I'll get the values and then we'll talk in next class. But let us say you're in this region. In general, especially, let us talk about gas turbine. Gas turbine is always lean. It never goes to stoichiometry. Okay, when that all we'll discuss in the last chapter when we talk about application. But when you what you're talking about, we are operating in this condition. Okay, so when you increase fuel, you're going to this region. You're not going here. You're going here only.
Okay, sir.
Okay, fine.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Any other question? Okay, fine. So we'll stop here today, and next week we'll meet on Microsoft. Okay, I will. So all of you have email ID. What is that? IIT.bhu.ac.in.
Sir, Naveen.
Naveen, I will wait for a minute. Let me finish with others.
Sir, it's yes. IIT BHU, not IIT. Just I.